Hello, students. This is your life science teacher, Mr. Pierce, with part two of your tropism lecture or notes. Again, my apologies. I have a baseball game, and all I do is win. But don't worry, this will be fun. So we have already covered phototropism as well as gravitropism, sometimes called geotropism. Now there is thermotropism. Thermotropism is a plant's growth and direction in response to heat. An example would be the rhododendron leaves that curl closed when it is cold outside to try and prevent some heat loss. Also, your trees in your yard are probably getting familiar with the weather warming up from our bitter cold winter. They are responding to the warmer weather as well as the longer days and are starting to leaf out. Again, if you ever need the video paused, please ask the instructor to pause it. Next up is thigmotropism. Thoughts on what thigmo, Latin roots, means? Did I hear it in the back there? Probably not. No. Thigmotropism is a plant's movement or growth in response to touch. Yes, touch, or the feeling of, or the sensation of feeling, is a stimulus, and they will respond to it. Some plants can curve and coil around a solid object when they feel it as they grow. A great example would be the morning glory plant. Also, mimosa plants can close shut when they are touched. Let us watch a video. As this plant is getting touched, it will close its leaves. This is known as the mimosa plant. I used to have a mimosa plant in the classroom, but then it died. This is an adaptation that the plant has in response to being touched too much by, let's say, animals, and trying to prevent itself from getting damaged when being touched. It is sometimes called the tickle me plant. It is sensitive to heat, if you did not see that. Oh yeah, that's enough of that. There's only so much of that music you can listen to. Perhaps I will add soundtracks to the following videos. Here is showing you the morning glory plant. Some plants possess modified leaves, stipules, or stems called tendrils. The tendrils provide support, plants coiling the structures around them. The growth is known as thigmotropism, from the Greek thigma, which touch.
Together, I think of your eyes looking in my not so much for me today. Come give me some sweet escape. Get next to me, come close to me. Grab hold of me, wrap you around me. Oh, 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 wrap you around me. Oh, 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 oh. Come take me in into that place only your love can take me.
This is another video of a Morning Glory. Unfortunately, this one does not have any good music that goes along with it. However, I did find some music to play while watching this video. It is also time-lapsed, just like the last Morning Glory video, but it goes much, much faster of a time-lapse. I will add the soundtrack after I start the video. That is enough of that. All right, moving on with thigmotropism. We got more videos to actually watch, but here's a little fun fact for you. The human skin can detect a thread weighing 0.002 of a milligram being drawn across the skin. Okay? However, the sundew plant can respond to a thread that is 0.008 of a milligram in weight, or mass, I should say. And a climbing tendril of the cycross actually responds to a thread weighing 0.025 of a milligram. Therefore, some plants are actually much, much more sensitive to touch than you. And even the sundew plant. We're going to watch a video of a sundew plant. This is showing you the sundew plant is sensing, The sundew plant is sensing the fly. The fly actually thinks that those little things that look like droplets think that it is nectar. And once it's very, very sticky, and once the fly touches it, it gets stuck, and the plant will actually wrap around it. The sundew plant is a carnivorous plant, much like the Venus flytrap. After it does that, it will release some enzymes that will actually digest it. By the term digest, it means it'll just break down the fly's nutrition. Carnivorous plants do not get energy by eating. They photosynthesize like any other plant. However, they're usually in nitrogen-poor soils is what they grow in. And a lot of animals may be nitrogen-rich in the area. Thank you. Do not feel bad for the flies. They do not have brains. They have collections of ganglia, but they are not brains. Here's a video of a Venus flytrap, another carnivorous plant. Again, they do not get energy from the insects. It is trying to get nitrogen because they live in nitrogen-poor soils. If you look at the inside of the flytrap's leaves, or whatever you want to call it, it's not a mouth, but you'll notice those little hairs. Those are what we call triggers. And actually, when the fly hits not one, it has to hit two of the triggers, the trap will automatically close. I actually used to have a couple of Venus flytraps, but then Miss Lowe just killed them. Perhaps on Monday when I am back at school, I will get a new one and we will test it out. Okay, students, so we are going to actually stop the notes here. There's more I want to talk about, but I would prefer to do that in person. The majority of this, we have just been watching YouTube videos. However, perhaps you are going to walk away today thinking, wow, plants are actually more interesting than I thought. And Mr. Pierce did a really good job at teaching me that. Wow. All right. On Monday, we are going to clean up our photosynthesis labs. And finish up tropism notes. That's all I got for you. Again, my apologies. I was not able to attend school today. At least in the afternoon. Well, sorry, not sorry. This has been your life science teacher, Mr. Pierce, from room 205. Goodbye. Bye.